You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Hi, I'm Jay Farner, CEO of Quicken Loans, America's largest mortgage lender. Spring will be here soon, so if buying a new home is on your to-do list, right now is the time to call Quicken Loans. Learn about which mortgage options make sense for you and get a jump on your competition. With our exclusive Rate Shield approval, the low rate you lock today is protected for up to 90 days while you shop for your new home. With a Rate Shield approval, if rates go up, your low rate stays locked. But if rates go down, you get that new, even lower rate. Either way, you win. Talk to us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com to take advantage. Here's another great reason to work with us. For a record 9 years in a row, J.D. Power has ranked Quicken Loans highest in the nation in customer satisfaction for primary mortgage origination. Again, to lock in today's low mortgage interest rate and get the security of our exclusive Rate Shield approval, call us today at 800-QUICKEN or go to rocketmortgage.com.
For J.D. Power award information, visit jdpower.com. Rate Shield approval only valid on certain 30-year fixed-rate loans. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
Hi, welcome to this Subway ad for the new Sesame Ginger Glazed Chicken Signature Wrap. How would you like it?
I'll take a...
Sports announcer at home?
Yeah, how'd you...
We just know.
My wife picks up the new Signature Wrap. It's got double the rotisserie-style chicken mixed with a sesame ginger glaze. She appears annoyed at me, but she shrugs it off. Those sweet and savory flavors are calling her name. She lifts the wrap and... She takes the bite! Incredible! And now she's closing the door on my... Subway, make it what you want.
Limited time only at participating restaurants. Double meat basement, average 6-inch sub.
I'm Little Teapot, short and stout.
Here is my handle and here is my spout.
No, Dad, like this. When I get all steamed up, then I shout. Tip me over and
pour me out.
This is WWE superstar Roman Reigns. It only takes a moment to make a moment. Take time to be a dad today.
Visit fatherhood.gov, brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Welcome to the Hardcore Patriot.
Must be Friday evening. I am the Hardcore Patriot, Alan Ray. Welcome to my show. We got a big one. I'm going to do something a little different today. I don't know how much you'll like it. I don't know how much you'll agree with it, but it's going to hit you square between the eyes because it is the truth. Don't go anywhere. I'll be right back.
Must have took me for a fool, cause they chucked me out of school, cause the teacher knew I had the fun.
To make a few adjustments with the microphone. I think I got it now. I hope it didn't rumble over the podcast. Oh, well, you know, you guys are used to it, right? Anyways, welcome to the show. Let's talk seriously for a moment. All right. I really didn't want to discuss the Donald Trump impeachment 2.0. The Schumer Pelosi clown show 2.0. The dog and pony show 2.0. The details, I don't really care. We can go back and forth about the details. We can holler about, you know, what they consider truth, what we consider truth, what the incitement is. I've got an entire soundtrack from the left inciting violence against the right. Does that mean they're all going to be punished? Is this setting a precedent? No. No, I don't believe so. I don't believe they want it to set a precedent because they're on a mission right now. And this is what I want to talk about. And I don't know how long this is going to take because I'm going to explain it to you. The way I'm seeing it and the way I feel is actually what's really happening. What you're seeing right now, and they're starting to say the quiet part out loud, but what you're seeing right now is not just an impeachment of Donald Trump. This is not just impeachment 2.0. They impeached him last year. Everybody rolled their eyes, said, whatever. You remember the Pelosi and little Jerry Nadler with his, you know, pants full of whatever, waddling down sanctimoniously to the Senate to hand over these articles of impeachment. And Schumer kind of looked at them and yawned and said, okay, run along. You know, the grownups have things to do. And they just chucked it off to the side. So when they got the second chance to, well, they, what they felt was the second opportunity to impeach Donald Trump, they ran after it. Now, Nancy Pelosi could have, she could have submitted these articles of impeachment to the Senate while Donald Trump was still in power. She did not. She waited until he was gone. He is no longer the sitting president. And let's face it, as you've heard in several episodes here on KLRN Radio, America's Podcast Network, has several episodes of all kinds of shows, that there's questionable constitutionality about impeaching somebody who is no longer a sitting president. Now, the Senate, in their glorious stupidity, has said that doesn't matter, which, who cares about what the Senate says? They're unconstitutional half the time. In fact, the way the Senate is set up right now is practically unconstitutional. We can argue about that another day. But what you have to realize is this is not simply about impeaching Donald Trump. It goes way, way deeper than that. It goes back way, way farther than that. Let me explain to you where, number one, what the thinking is. I'm going to explain to you what the thinking is first. And this is not easy for me because this involves a lot of thinking. And let's face it, folks, I pre-record this show early in the morning and the thinker is just not lubed up and firing at all eight cylinders right now, but I will do my best. First of all, let's establish a few facts. As much as they tout this, you are not a free person. Okay? You can argue. You can argue till you're blue in the face, and I will tell you, if you think you're free, then stop paying taxes. If you think you're free, go outside, take that license plate off of your car and chuck it off to the side and start driving around. If you think you're free, just start doing what you feel like doing, what you want to do. You're not free. You can live anywhere you want in this nation. As long as, when, if you buy property or if and when you buy a house, you pay taxes on that house. You're free to drive your car only if and as long as you pay the tax on that car in the form of a license. You're free to open up a business as long as you pay tax on that business, an exuberant amount of tax on that business, both local, state, and federal. You are not and have not been free as our forefathers constitutionally set up in the 1700s. You have not been exposed to that kind of freedom in your lifetime. That's just the way it is. Sorry you had to hear that from me. Sorry it's disturbing to you. But you are not free. But you'll come back and go, well, hell, I could go wherever I want. Yeah, I can go wherever you want in several nations. As long as you have papers. We have to have papers too. Cops can stop you at will and say, I want your identification. Now, you might say, well, we don't have to show identification. Yeah, you don't have to, and they can take you in and hold you for 24 hours without question. That's how free you are. Now, that's established. Number two, we are no longer a republic. We have not been a republic or a democracy in quite some time either. Shocking. Now, they will say we are a constitution republic. We are not. We have not been. We are definitely not a democracy. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, over the past two elections, you've seen it in play more than you've ever seen it. You, yes, get to vote. Who do you get to vote for, especially on a federal level? Now, local levels and state levels, okay, yeah, we're more of a republic. We're more of a, you know, democracy. You have the freedom to vote. You can run for any local position, and you should, if so inclined, fill your local positions with as many right-leaning people as we can, because we can only take back this country incrementally like we lost it. That's how we lost this country, is incrementally. We let these Marxist, communist, socialists get into these little bitty positions all over the country, and they eventually wormed their way up higher and higher and higher, and now, folks, we have a problem. Anyways, I digress. You get to vote for, on a federal level, out of a pool of the people who have that stamp of approval from either the Republican or Democrat Party. Case in point, 2016 election. Bernie Sanders was pulling out ahead of everybody else, out of the pack. This could not stand. He did not have the stamp of approval of the Democrat Party. Therefore, they changed the rules to short-circuit him, and he was basically lost in the primaries. Hillary Clinton. I did not see, and at the time, in 2016, I was traveling all over. I was out and about. It was right at that transition stage before I changed careers. But I was all over the place. I rarely ever saw a Hillary Clinton sign. Rarely ever saw a Hillary Clinton bumper sticker. She was a no one. There were Bernie Sanders bumper stickers and signs all over the place. That led me to believe that, well, here we go. It's going to be a Bernie Sanders versus Donald Trump. When they rolled out Hillary Clinton and all of a sudden she mysteriously just all of a sudden started winning everything and became the nominee, I started questioning, going, huh, that's curious. Who voted for her? Who voted in the primaries for Hillary Clinton? Well, let's go back a little bit too. Now, this 2020 election that just happened, again, Bernie Sanders was leading the pack. Joe Biden was at the very back of the pack. He was having a poor showing. And all of a sudden, overnight, within a week, he went from the very, very dead last candidate to leading, not just by a little bit, but a huge margin. Curious. And that's what really got me thinking about this. Now, same thing goes in the 2016 election with the Republicans. They rolled out Jeb Bush. The Republican Party, the establishment Republican Party, rolled out Jeb Bush and says, well, here's little Jeb Bush. His brother and his daddy were both president. You should vote for him. And everybody rolled their eyes and went, just no. They were hinging their bets on Jeb Bush being the candidate. You could tell by the way they were just promoting him in front of the press and all that. And at CPAC, everybody just yawned. Everybody went, yeah, okay, no. We don't need a royal family. We don't need the Kennedys. We don't need the Clintons. We don't need a royal family with three presidents, you know, all in the same family line. This isn't about royalty. And everybody flushed him down the toilet. Down the stairs in the meantime of the Trump Tower came this guy, Donald Trump. He was not handpicked by the Republican establishment. He was not bought and paid for by the big Republican donors. He was not financed by money from the Republican coffers. He had his own. Therefore, he could not be bought. He didn't have a political career. And even though they thought that they could blackmail him, he just laughed at them. And here's where it gets dicey, and here's my point. You only get to vote for, up until Trump, you only got to vote for the people who the establishment picked to put in front of you. That's not a democracy, my friends. That's not a representative republic. It's not. You know, they handpick four or five people, and they'll short-circuit the riffraff. You know, when you get people on the fringe, as a rule, usually, they'll short-circuit them. Politics is a nasty game. I was just reading an article about the little dark secret of opposition research and how nasty and horrible it is, and how that's how Kamala Harris basically ended up being your vice president and in danger of becoming the leader of this country. God forbid that day ever comes. But anyways, as a rule, you get to vote for who they pick for you. That's not a true representative republic. That's not chosen by the people. And this is the problem that the federal government had in 2016 when Donald Trump came down the stairs and said, "I am running for president." A, he was not one of them. He was not stamped, sanctioned, blessed by the establishment in Washington, D.C. In fact, he was an outsider. B, he partied with all these people, left and right. He partied with the Clintons. He partied with everybody in Washington, D.C. at one point or another. Now, he doesn't drink, but, you know, he was at their social gatherings. He donated to their campaigns, both sides. That's kind of what big businesses do. You know, they kind of donate to both sides and go, "Well, here you go." Because if one of the other sides wins, well, they can say, "Well, hey, we donated. So you kind of got to, you know, if you want this donation again, you got to help us out." It's smart business. That's what he did. He was not supposed to win the primary. He did. That sent shockwaves through the right. I didn't vote for him, tell you the truth. I didn't like him in 2016. I just rolled my eyes and went, "This is not live action TV." 2020 rolls around, and he's still wildly popular. This poses an even bigger problem for especially the left. In 2016, the left thought, "Oh gosh, we're just going to railroad Hillary Clinton through. She's going to be president and everything's going to be fine." The American people turned against Hillary Clinton. We know her. We know her. She was blessed by the establishment on the left. She had the stamp. She had the mark. And she was supposed to be president. And when it didn't happen, oh brother. Now, this goes back, and I'm going to tell you why this is important. This impeachment is, you know, this is all leading up to this impeachment. Trust me, stay with me here. Don't let me lose you. This all rolls back. This blessed by the establishment. You have to be in the establishment. You have to have the mark, the stamp, the blessings of either side or both sides. This rolls back to an idea that started soon after World War II. And I'm going to connect all the dots here, and I hope you stay with me. After World War II, the federal government, especially, had a problem on their hands. You see, we had just taken out two entire cities just by flying one plane over them and dropping one bomb on each city. Known as the Atomic Age, we had unleashed hell on earth for the Japanese people. Now, I'm not going to argue whether it was moral or not, whether it was right or not. It just happened. Okay, we did it. This led to the nuclear age. Now, starting out in the atomic age, the government had a problem on their hands. If we can do it, somebody else can do it. The Germans were already just at the cusp of figuring out atomic bombs. Russia, the Soviet Union, which it became, had figured it out, and they were starting to act on it. The Cold War was starting to fire up, and we realized that if we could do it to other people, people could do it to us. And at first, the federal government started out saying, you know, how do we save everybody? How do we save people in cities? How do we save people in suburban areas? How do we save as many people as we can from a nuclear holocaust? Well, they tried different things. You know, remember we had all them practice drills in school where you hid under your desk from a nuclear bomb. Yeah, you know, those desks were, they were titanium. They were plutonium. You could just like hide under them and the bomb just wouldn't affect you. Right? Wrong. We began to develop fallout shelters. We started, you know, making places in cities designated fallout shelters where you could go in case, you know, everything started going south and they had supplies in them. And you can still find some of these places and they still have old supplies in them. That probably doesn't mean anything. But as years go on, the thinking started, you know, they started reaching this conclusion that no matter what they did, no matter how they acted, and this is the federal government thinking, no matter what course of action they took, if a nuclear holocaust happened, we would probably lose the majority of lives in this nation. And slowly but surely, their thinking started turning from saving American lives to saving the government. And I believe in all my heart that this important moment in history, when they first started realizing that it's probably more, that continuity of government is more important than saving American lives, this is where the problem stemmed from that we have right now today. The government at that point in time supercharged the thinking and no longer became a government by the people for the people. It became a self-preserving entity that recoils and lashes out at anything that tries to go against the government. It is now the government to control the people. Yeah, you think you have input. They do a really good job of selling the fact that, you know, what your vote matters and blah, 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 whatever. What you have and what you're seeing right now is the final result of years of thinking, because the federal government went from, hey, let's see how many Americans we can save, to we have to have continuity of government at all costs. We have bunkers just outside of Washington, D.C. that we can run to if there's threat of a holocaust, if there's threat of anything. A meteor hitting the world and blowing it all up. We can bury ourselves in mountains. We have years and years and years of supplies. There is layers upon layers of people who can step into key positions in the federal government in case something happens in Washington, D.C. You know, you hear the conspiracy theorists talk about a shadow government. There really is a shadow government. The shadow government in actuality is people who can take the place of other people in case these people end up being devastated and can't get to these mountain forts and these underground bunkers and stuff in time. And if these other people do, they just take their place. There are layers of government. Don't believe me? I'll tell you what. I've got a book, a really good book by this guy named Garrett M. Graff. He was the author of The Threat Matrix. He has a book called Raven Rock, the story, the U.S. government's secret plans to save itself while the rest of us die. It is, and I've looked into Garrett Graff. I've looked into his Twitter account and all that. He probably leans left center. I could tell by his tweets and stuff like that. It doesn't matter. The book will really set your mind on fire. And you'll understand exactly what I'm talking about, that the government over the years has become a self-preserving, self-serving entity that lashes out and tries to destroy anything that rises up against it. Now, you got that in your head? You got that in your head? Enter Donald Trump. Donald Trump looks at the government, looks at the self-preserving, self-serving entity and says, you're too big, you're too powerful, you have too much control, and I'm going to turn things back over to the people. He didn't talk to the government. He spoke to the people. Uh-oh, you have problems. At this point, I'm going to take a break. I know it's only 25 minutes into this show, but when I come back, we're going to pick up from there and we're going to continue this thought, and I'm going to tell you why Donald Trump is being raked over the coals, and there in these people's minds will never, ever be a Donald Trump again. Don't go anywhere.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq. Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now, 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
Welcome back. I am the Hardcore Patriot, Alan Ray. Thank you for sticking with me. I know I was sort of bloviating there the first half hour, and I'm going to bloviate the second half hour. Guess what? That's what it's all about. Anyways, we have gotten now, we've caught up. You now know why the federal government is really self-preserving, self-serving. They're to protect themselves. They are a government to protect themselves. And because of this thinking, when you hear someone like Nancy Pelosi say, Donald Trump is a threat to America, what she means is Donald Trump is a threat to the government. She equates in her brain, she equates America with the government of America. When you hear Chuck Schumer says he's a threat to the government. Wait a minute. I got to do my Chuck Schumer voice. He's a threat to our government. What he means is he's a threat to America. What he means is he's a threat to the government of America. These people, you know, we talk about them living in a bubble, and it's actually pretty true. These people really do believe, and unfortunately, a lot of people on both sides of the fence, but mostly on the left, believe that the federal government is America. You can see that when there's a threat of a government shutdown. When both sides can't agree on a budget and a threat of a shutdown is looming, they stand up there and sanctimoniously say, shutdown is going to destroy America. No, it's not. No, it's not. It's not going to destroy America. The federal government, you could axe, you could literally cut 88% of the federal government and still not come close to shutting down America. Don't believe me? Do it. I think it'd be perfect. But the only thing you'd do is you'd have a lot of unemployed people who worked in the system. That's it. And they would probably end up finding jobs. And if there was a restrictions lifted, they could probably all start selling things and doing stuff. And they would all work eventually into society. We wouldn't need them. What these people mean is when they shut down the federal government is this is a threat to the government. It's not a threat to America. It's not going to paralyze the nation. I'll still get up and go to work. You'll still get up and go to work. We'll still get up and sell things and do things. And if the money collapses, well, we'll figure out different ways of paying for stuff. We've done this for over 240 years now. There used to be more than one currency. We survived. So, once you get where their thinking is, A, that they believe America is the government, and that anything outside of that government is expendable by their actions, once you believe that, that's B. So you've got, you know, the federal government thinks that the federal government is America, that the people in the country are more expendable than the government, and C, that unless you're blessed by the establishment, unless you have the stamp of approval on the left or the right, you do not belong in the Oval Office. You have to rise up through the ranks like each and every one of them do. You have to be bought and paid for by your side's money, by your side's lobbyists. They have to have dirt on you that they can either make you or destroy you in a day. And trust me, they have dirt on every one of these. Everybody in the government, they've got dirt on, I guarantee you. Once you realize these three factors, combined with the fact that this really isn't a free country or a representative democracy any longer, that it is a government to control the people, not a government by the people for the people. And they're pushing even harder to make it a government to control the people every day. The left is just going nuts. The right has been on the slow train to doing it. The left is just pushing like crazy because they know they're probably going to lose power in 2022 because everybody's waking up to the fact that they've elected an idiot for the president. Anyways, you combine all of these facts together, and you now are looking at the lens that you should be looking through at this impeachment. This is not just about Donald Trump, although it is a lot about Donald Trump. And The Hill actually said the quiet part out loud. says Senate Republicans, including those who do not plan to vote to convict former President Trump, says this week's impeachment trial has effectively ended any chance of him becoming the GOP presidential nominee in 2024. That was Nancy Pelosi's goal. That was Chuck Schumer's goal. They are terrified that Trump will get back into power. Now, The Hill also goes into some Republicans where senators became irate watching videos of the violence and chaos inside the Capitol on January 6th. Yada, yada, yada. Oh, my gosh. You know, footage of police officers being called pigs and traitors and one officer screaming he was crushed by rioters. That's been going on all through 2020. Where have you morons been? You only cared about it because it happened in your neighborhood. It's been going on in America's neighborhood all year. Again, look at it through the lens. The reason it didn't matter all year was because it was happening to the people, not the government. When it started happening to the government, it became America's problem. And, of course, the lapdog media for the left were all too willing to get that out there, that now this was an insurrection. The insurrection's been going on since the beginning of 2020. All summer long, when you were sitting there listening to block after block after block getting burned and looted, Portland, Seattle, Chicago, Los Angeles, New York, and it's going on in Washington, D.C. right now. The media's sitting on it. They don't want you to know that this is still going on. This is the insurrection. The problem is, it was about you being affected. When it became their problem, it happened in their front yard. It was their business that got broken into. Oh, boy. And see, this is what I'm talking about. Look at it through the lens of the government is self-preserving and self-serving. They don't care about you. They care about continuity of government. They have just basically, I don't think they care if they vote to impeach Donald Trump. Just people coming out and saying that this has effectively ended any chance Trump had of running in 2024, this was their goal. Now, this is not the only goal. Mark my words. This is not the only goal. Look at what Trump did for 4 years. He would get up in the morning, tweet something absurd. I hated it. I hated his tweets. I wanted somebody to just go in there and say, Mr. President, can I borrow that phone? And then take a hammer and just go, bam! But after a while, I realized what he was doing. He was talking to the American people. These sanctimonious morons don't talk to the American people in Washington, D.C. They speak at the American people. We're supposed to bow down at their feet and worship them. We're supposed to hang on every word. And you see some of these people. I seen a tweet in the middle of all of this stuff that somebody listed all of these Democrat politicians and said, they know more than we do. No, they don't. These are very stupid people. Very stupid people. These are people who are trying to pass gun laws and they don't know the first thing about guns and they don't care. All they want to do is strip you of your power. You can tell they don't know the first thing about guns, because if they really knew anything about guns, they would know that more murders happen with guns that are off the market, that are stolen or that are on the black market, than law-abiding citizens who actually have guns that are owned legally. And they would be spending their time and money going after these people. They don't, because they're not bright and they're evil. Anyways, I digress. What these people have effectively done, and I will almost stake what little reputation I have on the fact that going forward after this impeachment trial, there are going to be some procedures set in motion, some laws set in motion to make sure that you never have another Donald Trump again, ever, ever. They will make every effort to make sure that in your lifetime, in your kid's lifetime, in their kid's lifetime, there will never be another person who can't be bought and sold by the establishment, either on the left or the right. That's what they're pushing for. They don't want an outsider. Because think about the last 4 years. Donald Trump would get up in the morning, he would tweet something, and while the media was chasing that little laser light on the wall like cats, he was over there deregulating the EPA. He was over there moving the Bureau of Land Management and the FDA and places like that, reducing their size, moving them out away from Washington, D.C., into the places where they, oh my gosh, had to deal with the disgusting American public. How is that protecting America? America's the federal government. That's what these people think. Pay attention to what they act and how they act in different situations. He kept deregulating. Now, the last time I seen somebody deregulate like this was Ronald Reagan. And guess what? He was a threat to America too, which they meant he was a threat to the federal government. Oh my gosh, Ronald Reagan's going to get us all blown up. He's going to cause a nuclear holocaust. He's going to do this. He's going to do that. And what happened? He slimmed the government down, got him out of people's hair, and we had decades of great economy. And that's what you have with Donald Trump. It took an actual pandemic, and I'm sure there was a lot of money exchange, and I'm sure there was a lot of pressure, political pressure put on people to make darn sure that if you were a governor of a blue state, you crashed that economy hard. I live in one of them states. Some of the rules, some of the regulations, some of the queenly edicts that our governor put in place made no sense. None. Crashed an entire economy. Crashed an entire economy over a flu that only kills people from 60 up and only really affects people 70 and up. Everybody else gets it, gets over it, and gets back to work if you don't have pre-existing conditions. And now they're looking back, and even the World Health Organization is going, oh, well, maybe we did things wrong. The CDC, oh, well, maybe we did some things wrong. Oh, maybe our tests were cranked too low and the threshold was way too easy to put positives on people who had already had it or fought it off and should not have been tested positive. Of course, we're going to announce this after we got rid of that guy. See, Donald Trump just didn't scare the leaders here in America. He scared leaders all over the world. He scared them because he wasn't afraid to stand up to them. He wasn't afraid to look at China and say, you know what? You guys are a bunch of swindlers. You screwed us every way but Sunday, and we're going to start taking that back. He looked at North Korea, said, you want to play around with nuclear arms? We have nuclear arms. Ours work. Yours don't. You want to do this? What happened? North Korea buckled. They rolled over. He ended the Korean War, for God's sakes. What more do you people want? He established peace in the Middle East. But yet you in the media were too busy pointing out that he tweets mean things. He says bad things to the press. Who cares? Who cares? Nobody cared. I'm not even going to get into the legitimacy of the election. I think what happened, and I've seen this coming a mile down the road, is they went to all the battleground states that basically swayed the election in 2016 and fought like crazy to change election laws. Now, these same battleground states fell under a whole bunch of new election laws in the guise, in the name of, well, we got to do something different because of the coronavirus. So we're going to put all of these just boxes out there where anybody can just come along and dump a bunch of ballots. And we're going to have mass mail-in ballots where you don't really have to do anything but just fill them out. And we'll come by and pick them up for you. So they could technically say, okay, no, we didn't cheat. We just changed all of the laws so that we can sway the election. And now it's come out that they actually admit it. We actually have an article that says, yeah, we did that. We combined with big tech companies. We combined with all these people to fight Donald Trump. Because we knew he was going to win. We pretty much did what we, you know, accused Donald Trump of doing. We swayed the election. We did 10 times worse than what the Russians, what we accused of the Russians doing in 2016 and 2020. But hey, well, we won, so it's no big deal. pay attention to them when they tell you these things. It's disgusting. It really is. So, look at this Trump impeachment trial from the lens of the government thinks that they are America. You really don't matter to them, but they should matter 100% to you. They should be your God, your focus, who you pray for, who you thank, who you bless, who you bow down to from cradle to grave. They believe that they are America. And when they are threatened by deregulation, when they are threatened by a Donald Trump who comes in and says, I don't care about the establishment. This place is a swamp. I've had to deal with it long enough, and I'm going to drain it. And everybody in the United States goes, oh, listen to that. Okay, that is a direct threat to the government who believes they are America. Now, as far as the D.C. riots go, Matt Walsh's blog had the best thing on this. And somebody unrolled his Twitter thread here a while back. And I want to read this verbatim. We are told that the D.C. riot killed 5 people. Sometimes 7 deaths are linked to the riot. But here's the truth as far as we've been officially told. Of 7 deaths, 2 were officers who committed suicide after the riot. Okay, that leaves 5. We have never been given any evidence or any reason to believe that their suicides had anything to do with the riot. This simply is an assumption that many have made. Of the 5 who died in or shortly after the riot, 1 was a man with pre-existing conditions who suffered a heart attack. That's 4. Another suffered a stroke at some point that day and died in the hospital. That's 3. 3 left. 3 people. 1 woman collapsed while in a rush of people outside the Capitol and died. We were told she was trampled to death. The medical examiner never confirmed that as the cause of death. We have not been given any additional information. That leaves 2 people that may have been killed in the Capitol riots, technically. The 4th civilian death was Ashley Babbitt, and we all saw the video of that. She was an unarmed woman shot and killed by a Capitol Police officer inside the Capitol. The 5th actual death in the riot was Officer Sicknick. We have been given absolutely no official information about his death at all. The only thing they're telling us is that he was at the riot and later died. The autopsy results are being withheld. Nobody has been arrested for his murder. So of the 5 deaths linked to the riot, only 1, Babbitt, can be conclusively considered a death caused by violence during the riot. Only the violence in this case was done by a cop. That is what we know right now. If anyone knows more, they aren't telling us. Does this matter? Yes, because the truth matters. Also because the, quote, deadly riot, unquote, characterization is how they're justifying the military occupation of D.C. People died. It's tragic. But how and why really matter a lot. Thank you, Matt Walsh. Completely true. Now, that being said, during this impeachment, there's a big glaring hole going on right now. There's a white elephant in the room they don't want to talk about. At the end of its first day of argument, the Senate impeachment trial was thrown into chaos when a juror, quote unquote, stood up like a scene out of Perry Mason to contest the veracity statements made by prosecutors. That moment came as the Senate was preparing to end for the day. Senator Mike Lee, Republican Utah, jumped to his feet to object that a quote by House Manager Representative David Cicilline, a Democrat of Rhode Island, was false. Lee should know they were purportedly his words. After a frenzy on the floor and a delay of proceedings, lead House Manager Representative Jamie Raskin, a Democrat, Maryland, announced that they would withdraw Cicilline's statement and that this is much ado about nothing because it's not a critical, not critical in any way to our case. In reality, it had a lot to do about the manager's case and highlights a glaring problem. The House is elected to try this case of incitement of insurrection largely on circumstantial evidence and using media reports rather than witness testimony. It is trial by innuendo, an implication rather than direct evidence of what former President Donald Trump knew and intended on January 6th. Raskin added, "So we're happy to withdraw it on the grounds that it is not true, and we are going to withdraw it this evening without any prejudice to the ability to resubmit if possible, and when we could debate it if we need. It is not clear if the House will contest Lee's point further on the second day of the argument." Lee was aggrieved by Cicilline quoting him as to what Trump said in a cell phone conversation with Senator Tommy Tuberville, Republican Alabama, on January 6th. Trump mistakenly called Lee, who handed over the phone to his colleague. Here is where Cicilline said in part, "Senator Lee described it. Senator Lee then confirmed that he stood by as Senator Tuberville and President Trump spoke on the phone. And on that call, Donald Trump reportedly asked Senator Tuberville to make additional objections to certification process. That does not appear true if the suggestion is that Lee confirmed the content of the call in the article." So they've got a problem here. The source for the House managers was a story in Desert News that only describes the missed call and awkward moment before Lee grabbed his phone. Tuberville stated that he did not remember much of the brief call, but the article also states that Lee told newspapers that when Lee said when he later asked Tuberville about the conversation, he got the impression that Trump didn't know about the chaos going on in the Senate chamber. That's a big hole. And I agree with this guy. It's a trial of innuendo. It's a trial of what the media says about what's going on, not actual what happened. This is insanity. But you have to look at it through the lens of these people have to do this. And even if they know they're not going to get the votes to, quote, impeach, unquote, somebody who's really not impeachable, because impeachment means that's a step towards removing somebody towards office and he's no longer in office. It is a move. Let's call it what it is. It is a move to prevent Donald Trump or any of the Trumps of the future. And then by Trumps of the future, I mean anybody who is for the people and wants to deregulate the government and reduce the federal Leviathan. This is a move to make sure it never, ever happens again, ever. They can't have it. It was too traumatic to these people. It was too traumatic to their lapdog press members. The federal Leviathan has to be huge and out of control, and a money-sucking entity that wants more of your paycheck and more of your paycheck and more of your paycheck. You are a cow to them, and they will milk you. Every time they say, "We're going to tax the rich," they mean you. They mean you. If you have a job, you're rich in their eyes. They will not, mark my words, they will not stop until they own your entire paycheck. That's their end goal. They won't admit it. But if they could tomorrow walk into the Senate and say, "We could probably get away with telling people that 45, 50 hours a week you're working, we're just going to take your whole paycheck and pay all your bills for you." If they thought they can get away with that for a minute, institutionalize all of the grocery stores and everything, so you just work for the government and then you can just go get what you need as long as you get what the government says you need, and then everything will be peachy, everything will be fine. If they thought they could get away with that for a moment, they would do it, hands down. Hands down. They wouldn't live like that. They would still make a lot of money. They would still spend a lot of money. They would have boats, 6 houses, huge luxury cars, sports cars. You would get what they say you could get. If they thought they could get away with this, they would implement it tomorrow. And when somebody comes along and says, "You know what? You don't need that much money. We don't need to be $30 trillion in debt. You don't need to tax every single thing that walks, lives, breathes, and exists on this planet, in this country." When somebody comes along like that, the government recoils. Watch what they do. Watch how they act. Watch how they attack. how they curl up in a ball, circle the wagons, and start defending themselves. They don't care about Americans. They believe that they are the Americans, and we are just the underlings that should serve them. There you have it. That is why this impeachment trial is so important to them, and why everybody else is scratching their head going, why are they doing this to somebody who is no longer a sitting president? They have to. They have to because we can't have another Donald Trump ever again because it threatens the establishment in Washington, D.C. Mark my words and start writing down the names of the people who start going wishy-washy on the right. The people who start hinting that they kind of agree with what the left is doing, that's your establishment. Now, I'm still not a huge fan of Donald Trump. I'm going to say that flat out. I'm still not a huge fan of his. I have the right not to be. I understand what he did. I like a lot of stuff that he did. You bet your butt I voted for him in 2020. But I also will go to my grave telling people that what he did, the biggest thing he did in 4 years, is he got Washington, D.C. and the lapdog establishment press to expose who they really are to this nation. That's it. That's what I've got. Take it to heart. Think about what I said. If you agree with it, great. It's just, this is what I'm looking at. This is why I'm the hardcore patriot, because I look at things like this and I know that the establishment has been a threat to the American people, the American patriot, for decades, since before, way before I was born. And it gets worse and worse and worse every year. And now that we have basically a meat puppet in the Oval Office, somebody who is basically just a figurehead who there is an establishment pulling his string so his mouth moves, and it doesn't do a very good job of even doing that, we are going to see this government push very, very hard to the left, extremist left. It already is doing it. Extremist left. The Democrats basically have become extremists. They sit there and point to us as being extremists, but our opinions haven't moved. In fact, to tell you the truth, our opinions have softened, I think. In my world, the U.S. Constitution and the Bill of Rights is center. That is the center of politics. You come at it from the left, you come at it from the right, but that's the center of our politics. The people on the left now believe that it is a washed-up, old, redundant, meaningless piece of paper, and they want it eradicated. They've gone extremist. But yet they'll sit there and tell you, you have. Thank you so much for hanging out with me today. I hope this gets your brain clicking. I hope you do some research for yourself. Study the history from just after World War II up until now about continuity of government, what it means, what they're doing, how they basically turn their back on the people. And you'll understand why they recoil at the thought of somebody deregulating them, taking their precious fun and their money away. Because once you tap into that establishment, once you become part of it, you're set for life. You're set for life. You don't have to worry about another thing again, because you will have money, you will have power, you will have prestige. And if somebody threatens that, they must go. There can never be another Donald Trump again. I'm waiting for the laws and, you know, the party guidelines and everything to come out, where they will attempt to make sure that an outsider never gets inside again. I'm Alan Ray, the Hardcore Patriot. Thank you for listening. Keep it on KLR and Radio, America's Podcast Network. Everything is cool on this place. You get everything you can think of as far as podcast goes. We will talk again soon.